one of the interesting things that you do is that, I mean, this could have been done as a straightforward documentary. You could have had the interview and then we could have juxtaposed it with archival footage. But I really feel that it felt to me almost impressionistic. Like it, you had sections where the, you dramatized the film. You dramatized scenes from his life, as you did in the film on Al-Ghazali. And you also, interestingly, as the film progresses, we start out with a narrative of his life. But then there's a point where we start talking about Ibn Arabi, and maybe we'll get to that later. But it, the film kind of veers into a different direction, and it starts to become, it starts to enter almost like a spiritual realm. And it starts to go beyond the actual, the individual person into something much larger. Could you talk about your process of conceptualizing the film? Because I'm sure that the script, the screenplay, you must have gone through several rewrites of how exactly you want to convey the ideas.
It's a lovely question, because here's how I did it. I decided that I could have gone down there, met him, let's do a few interviews, bish bosh, and that's it. And I would have walked away with my money and Masalama, you know. But I thought, no, let's really give it the consideration that it deserves, and the respect that his ideas should naturally have. So I thought, how are we going to make this film? And I find that drama is something that we can kind of, allows us to go deeper into subjects sometimes. It's not just about the facts and the information that you impart, you know, that you can through talking heads, that I find that even though it's so-called drama, that you, by introducing dramatic elements, it allows you to get more under the skin and allows a kind of a different discourse. So the narrative can be shaped by visuals and by mood and by atmosphere rather than pure, simply, through the information. So on a date, here's how I did it. I would get up very early in the morning, every morning, and contemplate and meditate. And then the producer would come in, because I ended up staying in his living room in Tangier, right, because, you know, it was a limited budget. So I agreed to do it, but I said, okay, we'll take the time that's required and we'll do it. So every morning I would have like inspiration and right. I would come in, I would come in and say, oh, good morning. Right. Listen, I have an idea. What now? Another? So it was almost like, if you're going fishing and you're coming up with ideas.
Yeah.
So what we did initially was I interviewed Dr. Taha Abdurrahman once or twice, formally, you know, with the camera, and then got all of his thoughts and his ideas, and we spoke to some of his students and things like that to try and glean more information and to kind of try and decipher and find a way to elucidate his ideas
digest
exactly. So that's basically what happened is you know, it was like organic, it was formulated organically.
Right.
So then I thought, yes, if we're going to let's get to his origin story, if you want, his backstory.
Yes.
And then I thought, oh, well, this is nice because we can kind of recreate Morocco in the 60s and things like that. Yeah.
Down to the clothing as well and the glasses.
And so we went to the, you know, they have flea markets and things where you find all the old Detroiters. People have thrown out the glasses and the cheap, you know, the big suits and, you know, like that. So it was a creative, you know, challenge. But at the same time, I had the liberty of having the time to do it because that was very important. So that's how it happened. And
And someone is asking a question about what inspired you. I think you've partially answered this, but maybe you could go into a bit more detail. what inspired you to juxtapose the narrative with the everyday scenes of Morocco that the film showed with the snippets of Dr. Taha's philosophy? I think the idea here is that the film also shows us some lectures as well. And actually the language, when I first, the opening, I mean, when the opening scene of the film, you really go in and hit us with all these questions, and they're asking about Kant and things. And for me, it was like, okay, I don't know if I'm ready for this. But then after that, you lead us into the narrative of the film. What inspired the framing of the film within the context of a lecture? Because it begins and ends with that.
Yes. Well, my first introduction to Dr. Taha Abdurrahman was at that lecture. I hadn't met him before, but I had told them, please follow him from the time he leaves his house. And so I just think that we needed to hang the film on something. So it's like a frame, like a bezel, like if you know Ibn Arabi's bezel, Hufusus al-Hikam, you know, where you can set the ideas within that. So I obviously if it had just been a lecture, that would have been very boring. But I used that. I wanted to grab people like you right from the beginning, and okay, these are the subjects that we're going to kind of try and unpack.
Right.
But by showing that at the beginning and almost like a film, almost like in a theater where it opens with the screen, curtains. With the curtains.
And closes at the end.
Exactly. So you have a kind of a beginning and a middle and an end to it. So it's, I just thought, yes, by framing it that way, you could come back and you could hang the story around it, you know, like use it. I didn't know while I was editing whether it would be possible to actually do the whole film without resorting to having to show him in picture, you know, doing the interview.
Yes.
And so, but I do feel that when you're doing interviews in a film,
you step outside of the story.
Yes, you step outside of the story. And I wanted to kind of have it hermetically sealed. I wanted to keep it locked in so that you don't have to kind of, oh, now we're looking at B-roll. And you know what I mean by that, like sort of that you would lay over the interview. So I wanted to keep it integrated within the story.
We have another question coming in. The question is, I'm rather curious as to how did Professor Taha react to the film and what was his own response? I think that's a very good question. And so how involved was he in the process, actually?
All right. So he was very, you know, I think he had a slight reputation before we met of someone who was a bit guarded. So people didn't really know so much about his personal life. They knew about his books and they knew about his, you know, his philosophical concepts. But in terms of his person, that's why I also had at the beginning, like going, you know, craning up and going into his, you know, sort of like the wall, you know, the first shot where we cut away from the lecture.
The house.
Yeah, from the house. Yeah. Okay. So he was... once we got to, you know, you develop trust in someone when you're taking on a subject, you know, because they're allowing you into their lives, into behind the scenes, and as it were. So you build up, you know, and once we had a few chats and he knew, okay, I'm not just some kind of Johnny come lately, yeah, let's get the thing and be very casual about it, and that I treated it with due respect.
Yes.
Then he opened up a lot, and also allowed us to go with him to the Zawiya of the Bushishia to meet his sheikh, because all of that could have been very problematic, you know. And so I didn't tell him how I was going to do the film. He knew, he didn't. And so he kind of said, oh, you know, we kind of, after I'd conducted the interviews,
yes,
I kind of went away and then thought about it, and then we shot the drama bits. But he had no idea. He probably thought it was going to be a standard documentary, you know, where you, it's not drama, but it's talking to people and showing contemporary scenes. So, but I kind of tried to pick up as much like detail, subtle detail about him, like the way he sleeps at night with, you know, or yes. like that, you know, he put, and he actually, you know, yeah, that's right. Exactly. Those little things. And then he was very, you know, he bought into it. I mean, you know, he didn't know. And then we finally showed him a rough cut, because we didn't want to really, and, you know, and he was looking at his wife, in fact, to, you know, how is she going to react to this, you know, is she, and so he, we got the seal of approval, and then we went on to finish it. And then we got everyone together at the end, and, you know, the cinema that we showed the Ghazali film.
Yes.
That's my own sort of like, yes.
I wanted to ask you about that. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So we actually hired the cinema and showed this film for him and his friends and the cast and the crew. And it was a great feeling. I mean, you know, and he is apparently subsequently told people, if you want to know about me, watch this film or this like that, you know, mm-hmm. almost like a real, imprimatur, I mean, giving it
endorsement.
Endorsement, I mean, yeah, thank you, yeah.
The other, another question, when you mentioned Al-Ghazali, mm-hmm. Rihanna actually said that, I especially liked the scene where you included a snippet from The Alchemist of Happiness. Mm. Was that an attempt to link the two philosophers together? And I want to just add on, were you in the movie? Because I thought that there was a cameo or something like that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, of course, that was silly. But yeah, I'm at the beginning buying a ticket to go in to see the film. Okay. That was me. Now, yes, I absolutely thought, how can I introduce this idea and link them? Even though he, as he says in the film, he hadn't formally read the books of Ghazali before he was already on the path of Sufism, but you know, to try and show a correlation between his thought and Ghazali's own reflections and dealing with logic and things like that. So yes, I thought, well, this is the way to kind of dramatize, you know, again, bring more drama into it, and so that's kind of like a made up scene, obviously, right. You know. But because he didn't see the Ghazali film as a young man, but
the scene you chose was an interesting one, because mm-hmm. in that scene, and those of you who've seen the Al-Ghazali film, like Rehana and others, that scene, Al-Ghazali, and the subtitles were in French, but Al-Ghazali actually mm-hmm. nearly loses all his knowledge in a book. And he's actually told by a thief, he says that, you know, if I take this away from you, then you're nothing. Mm-hmm. Was there a significance to the particular choice of the scene? Because that was an interesting point to highlight.
There was. And that is to say that ultimately the knowledge that you're pursuing has to be kneaded into your soul. I mean, it's not just intellectual knowledge, it's not just information.
Yes.
And I think that, and that's very important philosophically, that we don't just assume that information and facts and what passes for, you know, true understanding has to come from a deeper place. And that's what the lesson that the thief, you know, that Ghazali received from that.
That brings me incident, to another question. The scene that I found very striking, as I say, the film actually moves into the story of Ibn Arabi. Mm. First of all, why do we go into Ibn Arabi's story rather than continuing what one would think would be the logical trajectory, which is to look at, to dramatize Taha Abdurrahman on a spiritual quest, but instead we go further back in time, we go back to Ibn Arabi. And secondly, there is this really almost eerie, it felt eerie to me, the scene with Ibn Arabi and Ibn Rushd, where Ibn Rushd is in darkness and Ibn Arabi is just standing there, and he says something about, and it's I think a quote, that there was a veil between them. And I didn't quite understand it, but there was something about it that I found very overpowering, but in an almost, you felt sort of, there was some kind of, it was uncomfortable, almost like Ibn Arabi didn't want to be standing there, something like that.
Look, that is from the Futuhat al-Makkiyah. So it is directly, I was verbatim dramatizing the words of Ibn Arabi in his three encounters with Ibn Rushd as a young beardless youth that he went, that his father had, because he had had kashf, he had had an unveiling. And Ibn Rushd, Averroes, was astounded to hear that a young man could actually receive this kind of revelation inspired kind of station without having to work for it, you know, because his whole thing was speculation and rational thought. And how could a young man receive this kind of illuminated state without having to do it? But he contrived to meet with him. And so these are all words taken directly from Ibn Arabi. And I just wanted to reinforce the idea of Taha Abdurrahman in a sense that because he had, you know, it's in a way in the modern world with spirituality is so, you know, neglected or misunderstood or misrepresented. Yes. And I think that because, you know, again, for the Arab world also, they're the idea of Sufism as a science is, you know, there's a lot of ambivalence. People aren't willing to kind of accept that this is all part of traditional Islamic science, much in the way of ilm al-kalam or, theology or jurisprudence, or, you know, it is a science that if you follow it produces results.
Yes.
And so I think Taha Abdurrahman's thought is very much connected to that. And I just, again, like in the way that we linked Ghazali, I wanted to further the
connection.
The connection and impress upon people that this is a kind of a viable methodology.
Yes.
So, but as far as, sorry, about the veil, again, that's something where this was, again, it was a kind of an inspired state that Ibn Arabi had of a vision, as it were, of Ibn Rushd, that he wasn't privileged to meet him again until after he had already died. And then they were bringing his
body.
Yeah, the body.
Yeah. And one of the other point that is made here, it links philosophy and Sufism together, and which is not, I think in the modern world, we tend to disconnect the two. We disconnect, and not just in Islam, there's a tendency to disconnect something academic, which philosophy is perceived as academic, cerebral, with Sufism or mysticism more generally, which is seen as something of emotional experience. And I was not aware of this, but he made in the film a distinction between two types of Sufism. One he calls cognitive, and I think the other he called purificatory Sufism.
Yeah, tabarik or something like this.
Right. Could you explain the links between those two themes in the film and how exactly that comes out, especially how you try to present that? Because again, the concepts are abstract.
Yeah. Well, look, first of all, I have to apologize that at the shoddy translations of the subtitles, and I don't know, but I'm just saying that the Arabic, the English translation, I don't think it did justice to his words. And so there could be room for misinterpretation and that. But again, he was just because he had been visiting the maqbara, the tombs of some of the of the shuyukh, of the saint, of the sheikhs, of the Bushishia order. And then I think I wanted to kind of allow him to kind of unpack the notion of Sufism, because like we say, it's very misunderstood. And you know, there and he was trying to kind of make this differentiation between people that just go in for, you know, the karamat and the, you know, the miracles and the
experience. You
know, the experience, exactly.
Yeah.
And something that's a bit more deeper that brings one to ma'rifat, yes. Ma'rifat Allah. So I think that's, I was only trying to give an indication that this is, you know, this is the path of that he's on.
Right. And another question, and before, I think, well, how long, we've actually reached our time limit. Would you like to continue a little more? Or?
I'm absolutely fine.
Okay.
I mean, it's the middle of the day here. It's not.
Oh, I see. You know, all right.
Yeah, yeah. I'm in London, so you're.
Okay.
You guys are what, 9:30 or 10 o'clock or something?
10 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
But I think everyone's really, really keen to, so, because we're now getting quite a few questions coming in. So
uh-oh.
I'll go on for a little while. A little while.
No, it's good. It's good.
One of the questions that's just come up, I'm an Aslan. She says, it says, I really appreciated how the film treated the influence of tasawwuf on Taha Abdurrahman's philosophy. And this person was particularly moved by the scene of him holding the dhikr beads and visiting the Zawiya. Mm-hmm. What was the reception to these shots when you showed the film elsewhere? Did the audience resonate with them? And did they understand the connection? Because you really paint kind of like, there are, some of them are not even narrative. They're almost like pictures. You know, you have the camera there and you just have him with the prayer beads and things like that. So how did people, was there a reaction, an audience reaction?
Fortunately, I mean, anything was positive that it was shown on Al Jazeera television on the broadcast.
Right.
And other than that, I've only shown it in a few festivals. So it's really a very unseen film, as it were, you know, because, you know, and I was very honored that you invited us to show it. But no, I think, you know, look, there is this kind of debate whether things are bid'ah or that, but I think people, you know, the people that are watching this film appreciate, you know, that this is all part of the tariqah, of his
yes.
tariqah, and that.
Absolutely.
So, you know, there's no argument or there's no sort of contradiction to him being a philosopher and,
right.
and using a tasbih.
The other thing that I wanted to ask, I noticed that the one of the themes that crops up in this film, and actually in a lot of your films, is the idea of a journey.
Mm.
Like most film about journeys, the Hajj, journey to Mecca, they're all oriented and not necessarily on the pilgrimage. And in this film, we constantly see them, the characters are constantly traveling.
Yeah.
There are always these shots of them on the road and things. What was the significance of including that? Because spirituality and philosophy can be very abstract, but this really felt like you felt like the characters were always constantly undergoing an inner journey.
Yeah.
And that you could see that taking place.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, because you got the film. I mean, that's exactly right. Because it is about Sayyar al-Suluk. It is about the Suluk. It is about the journey from the soul and of traversing the stages of existence. And so, as you know, when he's a young man and he's traveling, he starts talking about tasawwuf. He's in the old car, but the road is kind of like the slow. I've slowed down the footage, so it's
yes.
going like that. And then when he's on the way, where he starts talking about his sheikh, we're going through the fields and the wind is blowing and like that, and the light
right.
is shining. And so it was very much a conscious decision to try and show. As you know, have this journey, have the travel being representational of the inner journey. So, And then at the end he gets to the Zawiya, I think, after. Right. You know, I didn't just kind of like, I don't like making straightforward, you know what I mean, films that are just very one-dimensional. Hopefully that there's layers to it, and cutting back and forth between times and things like that is always something that I feel, you know, we want to be in, even a waqt, to live in the moment, to be the son of the moment. So,
one last question perhaps before we go.
Sure.
Could you leave us perhaps with what the essential message of the film is, and perhaps your intentions in making the film, as in inwardly what you would hope people take away from screenings of this film, and really hope that this film is shown not just here but elsewhere and continues to be shown.
Yeah. Well, look, I think the film speaks for itself in that sense, that everything that I think he wanted to, that I could try and encapsulate in 60 minutes, how his journey has taken him from one of just, you know, having a straightforward traditional understanding of Islam. Nothing particularly out of the ordinary. I mean, yes. You know, except when he was a child, and then the sheikh gave him that kind of the
baraka.
The baraka, exactly. And so all of these ideas, I don't know if they're foreign or not. They shouldn't be. But unfortunately, I think in the modern world, we're faced with the fact that people aren't as educated in traditional sort of ways of looking at, you know, things that were taken for granted before or normal. Suddenly they're kind of like anomalies that we don't, you know. And I think it's important that Taha Abdurrahman's thought is, again, it's a critique of the modern man and of Muslims who emulate the West but not really grasp it, you know, without taking, you know, having their own Islam solidified in traditional think, you know, contemplative methods of
a worldview.
A worldview, exactly. Yeah. Thank you. Exactly that. And the worldview, precisely. You got it. So I think that is no, thank you, really. It's really, Sidi, when someone, you know, great minds, you know, it's like, you know, because let's face it, not everyone gets it, you know, and so I could show that film and they'll say, well, what was that? It's like, people that really kind of, you put something into the world and you pray that people are receptive and they grasp it, and that your aim, you know, in trying to kind of illustrate some points are appreciated and received, and that we all benefit from that. You know, our knowledge is increased in that.
Yes. Well, thank you so much, Sidi Ovidio. It's been so nice to have a conversation with you.
Likewise. And thank everyone. Thank you all for attending. And look, I have other films. If any time you'd like to see,
absolutely, see them,
just let me know if your film club is...
Absolutely, and we would really love to have you back again, maybe even in December. And many people are saying on the chat, they're saying, thank you, great session. Please, we'd love to have another film from you again.
With great pleasure. Thank you.
So thank you much. Thank you very much, Sidi Ovidio, for sharing the film and this experience, and actually taking the time really to discuss the film with us. It's really wonderful to have this insight into behind the curtain, as it were, to really see what it.
Yes,
what it
is. And you did know at the end of the film, you know, this, when the titles are coming on, that song is from Ibn Arabi's "My Heart Has Become Capable of All Forms." You know, it's like I follow the religion of love, basically. So it's from that classic Ibn Arabi poem.
Inshallah.
So I try, and also look, I do try and put little subtle things in there in the film that, you know, like
the
when
nuances.
Nuances, exactly. But let me ask, are you a filmmaker yourself?
No, I'm not a filmmaker. Oh. I do direct videos.
Oh, well, all right. We're talking in the same.
I direct videos and write screenplays for the videos.
Oh, great.
But I just, the point you made about the music, I know I said it would wrap up, but since you raised the point, the point about the music, I didn't get it the first time, but I was listening to it the second time with earphones. Mm. And I really realized the use of sound, that you're really making a lot of use of sound in the film, and that the soundtrack varies, that you actually, you begin with, and in the scene in the 1960s is Uncle Film.
Yes.
You then go into a kind of French accordion-like sound,
yes,
and you move into,
yes.
And, but the scene that really struck me this time around was the scene of modern, I think it was Morocco, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But it looked almost like an MTV music video.
Yeah.
I just was wondering what we're trying to encapsulate with the changes in the sound, because we get so caught up in the visuals, we don't notice how much effort goes into the sound editing,
yeah,
and how much that really affects us when we're watching the film.
Yeah. Well, look, I mean, that bit was like the drum and bass in that, which was kind of like a modern Moroccan sort of hip-hop-y thing, but done with this kind of intensity, and it's almost aggressive. It is kind of like very disruptive. And that was like that interlude where I've kind of going between, you know, super fast shots of modern, you know, where we're all distracted. We're all caught up in the rush of the modern world. So we're losing our equilibrium.
Yeah.
And that was just a little interlude. And then it ends with Hercules with the two
with a statue like that.
Yeah, exactly. Kind of the West and the East.
Right.
And he's holding them again while it's all crumbling down around us.
And you got this shot with the heads, like at the, you began with the train and with the head of, I think it was like an abstract thing of just the head itself, and then you end it also toward the end.
Oh, yes.
And it really felt like there was such a contrast between that and then seeing the Zawiya with all the Moroccan tiling and things. It was almost like they're two entirely different. It's the exact same place geographically, but it's almost like there's a different, it's a different world almost.
Yeah.
Well.
You didn't notice, but I also tried to include bird song right throughout the entire film in most of the shots that I could.
I noticed.
Yeah.
And that was the significance of the,
of the birds?
Yes.
It's the conference of the birds.
Oh, right.
Yes. No, but you know how our thoughts are almost like inspirations, or birds are
the
very
symbolism of it.
Exactly, very, very symbolic of that.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Sidi.
Guys, really a great pleasure. Thank everyone again for coming along. And let's look forward to another session.
Thank you, Sidi.
Yeah, really a great pleasure. I hope I can join you one day for a tea tariq in Mocha.
Inshallah.
Inshallah. All right.
When you can come down.
I hope so. Soon, inshallah.
Inshallah.
All right. Fadha hafiz.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.